Long lines of cliff breaking have left a chasm. And in the chasm are foam and yellow sands. Beyond, red roofs about a narrow wharf in cluster, then a moldered church. And higher, a long street climbs to one tall towered mill, and high in heaven behind it, a gray down with Danish barrows, and a hazelwood by autumn nutters haunted, flourishes green in a cup-like hollow of the down. Here, on this beach, 100 years ago, three children of three houses. Annie Lee, the prettiest little damsel in the port. And Philip Ray, the miller's only son. And Enoch Arden, a rough sailor's lad, made orphan by a winter shipwreck. Played and built their castles of dissolving sand to watch them overflowed. A narrow cave ran in beneath the cliff. In this the children played at keeping house. Enoch was host one day, Philip the next, while Annie still was mistress. But at times, Enoch would hold possession for a week. "This is my house, and this my little wife. Mine too," said Philip, "turn and turn about." When, if they quarreled, Enoch, stronger made, was master, then would Philip, his blue eyes all flooded with a helpless wrath of tears, shriek out, "I hate you, Enoch." And at this, the little wife would weep for company, and pray them not to quarrel for her sake, and say she would be little wife to both. But when the dawn of rosy childhood passed, and the new warmth of life's ascending sun was felt by either fixed his heart on that one girl, and Enoch spoke his love, but Philip loved in silence. And the girl seemed kinder unto Philip than to him, but she loved Enoch, though she knew it not, and would, if asked, deny it. Enoch set a purpose evermore before his eyes to hoard all savings to the uttermost, to purchase his own boat and make a home for Annie. And so prospered that at last a luckier or a bolder fisherman did not breathe for leagues along that breaker-beaten coast than Enoch. Likewise, had he served a year on board a merchantman and made himself full sailor, and ere he touched his 21st May, he purchased his own boat and made a home for Annie, neat and nest-like, halfway up the narrow street that clambered toward the mill. Eventide, the younger people making holiday with bag and sack and basket great and small, went nutting to the hazels. Philip stayed, his father lying sick and needing him an hour behind. But as he climbed the hill, just where the prone edge of the wood began to feather toward the hollow, saw the pair, Enoch and Annie, sitting hand in hand. His large gray eyes and weather-beaten face, all kindled by a still and sacred fire that burned as on an altar. Philip looked, and in their eyes and faces read his doom. Then, as their faces drew together, groaned, and slipped aside, and like a wounded life, crept down into the hollows of the wood. While the rest were loud in merrymaking, had his dark hour unseen, and rose and passed, bearing a lifelong hunger in his heart. So these were wed, and merrily rang the bells, and merrily ran the years, seven happy years of health and competence, and mutual love and honorable toil, with children. First a daughter. In him woke with his first babe's first cry, the noble wish to save all earnings to the uttermost, and give his child a better bringing up than his had been or hers, a wish renewed when 2 years after came a boy, to be the rosy idols of her solitude while Enoch was abroad on wrathful seas. Then came a change, as all things human change. 10 miles to northward of the narrow port opened a larger haven. Thither used Enoch at times to go by land or sea, and once when there, and clambering on a mast in harbor, by mischance, he slipped and fell. A limb was broken when they lifted him, and while he lay recovering there, his wife bore him another son, a sickly one. Another hand crept too across his trade, taking her bread and theirs, and on him fell, although a grave and staid, God-fearing man, yet lying there in active doubt and gloom. He seemed as in a nightmare of the night to see his children leaving evermore low, miserable lives of hand to mouth, and her he loved, a beggar. Save them from this, whatever comes to me. And while he prayed, the master of that ship Enoch had served in, hearing his mischance, came, for he knew the man and valued him, reporting of his vessel China-bound, and wanting yet a bosun, would he go? There yet were many weeks before she sailed from this port, would Enoch have the place? And Enoch all at once assented to it, rejoicing at this answer to his prayer. So, now that the shadow of mischance appeared no graver than as when some little cloud cuts off the fiery highway of the sun and isles alight in the offing, yet the wife, when he was gone, the children, what to do? Then Enoch lay long pondering his plans to sell the boat. And yet he loved her well. How many a rough sea had he weathered in her? and yet to sell her. Then, with what she brought, buy goods and stores, set any forth in trade with all that seamen needed or their wives. So might she keep the house while he was gone. Thus, Enoch in his heart determined all, and moving homeward came on Annie, pale, nursing the sickly babe, her latest born, whom Enoch took and fondled father-like, but had no heart to break his purposes to Annie till the morrow, when he spoke. Then first, since Enoch's golden ring had girt her finger, Annie fought against his will, yet not with brawling opposition she, but manifold entreaties, many a tear, many a sad kiss by day and night renewed, sure that all evil would come out of it, besought him, supplicating, if he cared for her or his dear children, not to go. He, not for his own sake caring, but her and her children, let her plead in vain, so grieving, held his will and bore it through. For Enoch parted with his old sea friend, bought Annie goods and stores, and set his hand to fit their little streetward sitting room with shelf and corner for goods and stores. So all day long, till Enoch's lass at home, shaking their pretty cabin, hammer and axe, auger and saw, till this was ended. And he, who needs would work for Annie to the last, ascending, tired, heavily slept till morn. And Enoch faced this morning of farewell brightly and boldly. All his Annie's fears, save as his Annie's, were a laughter to him. Annie, this voyage, by the grace of God, will bring fair weather yet to all of us. Keep a clean hearth and a clear fire for me, for I'll be back, my girl, before you know it. Then, lightly rocking baby's cradle, and he, this pretty, puny, weakly little one, nay, for I love him all the better for it. God bless him. He shall sit upon my knees, and I will tell him tales of foreign parts, and make him merry when I come home again. Come, Annie, come cheer up before I go. Him running on thus hopefully she heard, and almost hoped herself. But when he turned the current of his talk to graver things, in sailor fashion roughly sermonizing on providence and trust in heaven, she heard, but heard him not. At length, she spoke. O Enoch, you are wise, and yet for all your wisdom, well I know that I shall look upon your face no more.
Well then, said Enoch, I shall look on yours. Annie, the ship I sail in, passes here. Get you a seaman's glass. Spy out my face and laugh at all your fears.
But when the last of those last moments came, Annie, my girl, cheer up, be comforted. Look to the babes. Until I come again, keep everything shipshape, for I must go. And fear no more for me, or if you fear, cast all your cares on God. That anchor holds. The sea is his. He made it. Enoch rose, cast his strong arms about his drooping wife, and kissed his wonder-stricken little ones. But for the third sickly one, who slept after a night of feverous wakefulness, when any would have raised him, Enoch said, wake him not, let him sleep.
How should this child remember this? And kissed him in his cot. But Annie, from her baby's forehead, clipped a tiny curl and gave it. And this he kept through all his future, but now hastily caught his bundle, waved his hand, and went his way. But all in vain. Perhaps she could not fix the glass to suit her eye. Perhaps her eye was dim, hand tremulous. She saw him not. And while he stood on deck waving, the moment and the vessel passed. Even to the last dip of the vanishing sail, she watched it. And departed, weeping for him. Then, though she mourned his absence as his grave, set her sad will no less to chime with his, but throve not in her trade, not being bred to barter, nor compensating the want by shrewdness, and still foreboding, what would Enoch say? And thus, expectant of that news that never came, gained for her own a scanty sustenance, and lived a life of silent melancholy. Now, the third child was sickly born and grew yet sicklier, though the mother cared for it with all a mother's care. Nevertheless, whether her business often called her from it, or through the want of what it needed most, or means to pay the voice who best could tell what most it needed, howsoe'er it was, after a lingering, ere she was aware, like the caged bird escaping suddenly, the little innocent soul flitted away. Thank you. that same week that Annie buried it, Philip's true heart, which hungered for her peace, since Enoch left, he had not looked upon her, smote him as having kept aloof so long. Surely, said Philip, I may see her now, may be of some little comfort. Therefore went, passed through the solitary room in front, paused for a moment at an inner door, then struck it thrice, and no one opening, entered. But Annie, seated with her grief fresh from the burial of her little one, cared not to look on any human face, but turned her own toward the wall and wept. Then Philip, standing up, said falteringly, Annie, I came to ask a favor of you. His bashfulness and tenderness at war, he set himself beside her, saying to her, I came to speak to you of what he wished. Enoch, your husband, I have ever said you chose the best among us, a strong man. And wherefore did he go this weary way and leave you lonely, but for the wherewithal to give his babes a better bringing up than his had been, or yours? So Annie, now, I do beseech you by the love you bear him and that his children not to say me nay, for if you will, when Enoch comes again, why then you shall repay me, if you will, Annie, for I am rich and well-to-do. Now, Annie, let me put the boy and girl to school. This is the favor that I come to ask. Then Annie, with her brows against the wall, answered, I cannot look you in the face. I seem so foolish and so broken down. When you came in, my sorrow broke me down. And now I think your kindness breaks me down. But Enoch lives. This is borne in on me. He will repay you. Money can be repaid, not kindness such as yours. There she turned, she rose, and fixed her swimming eyes upon him, and dwelt a moment on his kindly face, and calling down a blessing on his head, caught at his hand and wrung it passionately, and passed into the little garth beyond. Then Philip put the boy and girl to school and brought them needful books and every way made himself theirs. And though for Annie's sake, fearing the lazy gossip of the port, he oft denied his heart his dearest wish and seldom crossed her threshold, yet he sent gifts by the children, garden herbs and fruit, the late and early roses from the wall, and Philip was her children's all in all. Lords of his house and of his mill were they, worried his passive ear with petty wrongs or pleasures, hung upon him, played with him, and called him Father Philip. Philip gained as Enoch lost. For Enoch seemed to them uncertain as a vision or a dream, faint as a figure seen in early dawn, down at the far end of an avenue going we know not where. And so, 10 years since Enoch left his hearth and native land, fled forward. And no news of Enoch came. Annie would go with them. Then they begged for Father Philip, as they called him too. Him, like the working bee in blossom dust, blanched with his mill, they found, and saying to him, "Come with us, Father Philip," he denied. But when the children plucked at him to go, he laughed, and yielding readily to their wish, for was not Annie with them, and they went. But after scaling half the weary down, just where the prone edge of the wood began to feather toward the hollow, all her force failed her, and sighing, "Let me rest," she said. But Philip, sitting at her side, forgot her presence and remembered one dark hour here in this wood, when, like a wounded life, he crept into the shadow. "At last," he said, lifting his honest forehead, "listen, Annie, how merry they are down yonder in the wood." "Tired, Annie?" For she did not speak a word. "Tired?" But her face had fallen upon her hands. Then Philip, coming somewhat closer, spoke. "Annie, there is a thing upon my mind, and it has been upon my mind so long, I know that it will out at last. Oh, Annie, it is beyond all hope, against all chance, that he who left you 10 long years ago should still be living. Well, then, let me speak. I grieve to see you poor and wanting help. I cannot help you as I wish to do, unless perhaps you know what I would have you know. I wish you for my wife. I fain would prove a father to your children. I do think they love me as a father. I'm sure that I love them as if they were mine own. And I believe if you were fast my wife, that after all these sad, uncertain years, we might be still as happy as God grants to any of his creatures. Think upon it." Then answered Annie. Tenderly she spoke. "You have been as God's good angel in our house. God bless you for it. God reward you for it, Philip, with something happier than myself. Can one love twice? Can you be ever loved as Enoch was? What is it that you ask?" "I am content," he answered, "to be loved a little after Enoch." "Oh," she cried, "dear Philip, wait a while. If Enoch comes..." "But Enoch will not come. Yet wait a year. A year is not so long. Oh, wait a little." Philip sadly said, "Annie, as I have waited all my life, I well may wait a little." "Nay," she cried, "I am bound. You have my promise. In a year." And Philip answered, "I will bide my year." Then all descended to the port, and there at Annie's door he paused and gave his hand, saying gently, "Annie, when I spoke to you, that was your hour of weakness. I was wrong. I'm always bound to you, but you are free." Then Annie, weeping, answered, I am bound. She spoke. And in a moment, as it were, while yet she went about her household ways, even as she dwelt upon his latest words, that autumn into autumn flashed again, and there he stood, once more before her face, claiming her promise. Is it a year? She asked. Yes, if the nuts, he said, be ripe again, come out and see. But she put him off so much to look at, such a change. A month, give her a month. She knew that she was bound, a month no more. Then Philip, with his eyes full of that lifelong hunger, and his voice shaking a little like a drunkard's hand, take your own time, Annie. Take your own time. And Annie could have wept for pity of him, and yet she held him on delayingly till half another year had slipped away. By this, the lazy gossips of the port began to chafe, as at a personal wrong. Some thought that Philip did but trifle with her, some that she but held off to draw him on, and others laughed at her, and Philip too, as simple folks that knew not their own minds. And one, in whom all evil fancies clung like serpents' eggs together, laughingly would hint a worse in either. Her own son was silent, though he often looked his wish. But evermore the daughter pressed upon her to wed the man so dear to all of them, and lift the household out of poverty. And Philip's face, contracting, grew careworn and wan, and all these things fell on her, sharp as reproach. At last, one night, it chanced that Annie could not sleep, but earnestly prayed for a sign. My Enoch, is he gone? Then started from bed and struck herself a light, then desperately seized the holy book, suddenly set it wide to find a sign, suddenly put her finger on the text. Under a palm tree? That was nothing to her, no meaning there. She closed the book and slept. When lo, her Enoch, sitting on a height under a palm tree. And these be palms whereof the happy people strewing cried, Hosanna in the highest. Sent for him and said wildly to him, there is no reason why we should not wed. Then for God's sake, he said, both our sakes, so you will wed me, let it be at once. Never merrily beat Annie's heart. A footstep seemed to fall beside her path. She knew not whence. A whisper
in her ear, she knew not what. Nor loved she to be left alone at home, nor ventured out alone. What ailed her then, that ere she entered, often her hand dwelt lingeringly on the latch, fearing to enter? Philip thought he knew. Such doubts and fears were common to her state, being with child. But when her child was born, then her new child was as herself renewed. Then the new mother came about her heart. Then her good Philip was her, all in all. And that mysterious instinct wholly died. Sailed the ship Good Fortune, though it setting forth the Biscay, roughly ridging eastward, shook and almost overwhelmed her. Yet, unvexed, she slipped across the summer of the world. Then, after a long tumble about the Cape and frequent interchange of foul and fair, she, passing through the summer world again, the breath of heaven came continually, and sent her sweetly by the golden isles till silent in her oriental haven. Less lucky her home voyage, at first indeed through many a fair sea circle day by day, then followed calms, then winds variable, then baffling, a long course of them, at last storm, such as drove her under moonless heavens, till hard upon the cry of breakers came the crash of ruin, and the loss of all, but Enoch and two others. Half the night, buoyed upon floating tackle and broken spars, these drifted, stranding on an isle at morn, rich but loneliest in a lonely sea. No want was there of human sustenance. Soft fruitage, mighty nuts, and nourishing roots. There, in a seaward-gazing mountain gorge, they built and thatched with leaves of palm a hut, half-hut, half-native cavern. So the three, set in this Eden of all plenteousness, dwelt with eternal summer, ill content. For one, the youngest, hardly more than boy, hurt in that night of sudden ruin and wrack, lay lingering out a 3 years' death in life. They could not leave him. After he was gone, the two remaining found a fallen stem, and Enoch's comrade, careless of himself, fire hollowing this in Indian fashion, fell sun-stricken. And that other lived alone.
In these two deaths, he read God's warning. Wait. The mountain, wooded to the peak, the lawns and winding glades high up like ways to heaven, the slender cocoa's drooping plowed crown of plumes, the lightning flash of insect and of bird, the luster of the long convolvuluses that coiled around the stately stems and ran even to the limit of the land, the glows and glories of the broad belt of the world, all these he saw. But what he fain had seen, he could not see. The kindly human face, nor ever hear a kindly voice, but heard the myriad shriek of wheeling ocean fowl, the league-long thunder rolling on the reef, or the sweep of some precipitous rivulet to the wave as down the shore he ranged, or all day long sat in the seaward-gazing gorge, a shipwrecked sailor waiting for a sail. No sail from day to day. But every day the sunrise, broken into scarlet shafts among the palms and ferns and precipices, the blaze upon the waters to the east, the blaze upon his island overhead, the blaze upon the waters to the west, then the great stars that globe themselves in heaven, the hollower bellowing ocean, and again the scarlet shafts of sunrise, but no sail. As he watched, or seemed to watch, so still the golden lizard on him paused. A phantom, made of many phantoms, moved before him, haunting him, or he himself moved, haunting people, things, and places known far in a darker isle beyond the line. Annie, the small house, the climbing street, the mill, the leafy lanes, the horse he drove, the boat he sold, the chill November dawns and dewy blooming downs, the gentle shower, the smell of dying leaves, and the low moan of leaden-colored seas. Once, likewise, in the ringing of his ears, though faintly merrily, far and far away, he heard the pealing of his parish bells. Then, though he knew not wherefore, started up, shuddering. And when the beauteous, hateful isle returned upon him, had not his poor heart spoken with that which, being everywhere, lets none who speaks with him seem all alone? Surely the man had died of solitude.
equinox early silvering head. The sunny and rainy seasons came and went, year after year. His hopes to see his own and pace the sacred old familiar fields not yet had perished when his lonely doom came suddenly to an end. Another ship, she wanted water, blown by baffling winds like the Good Fortune from her destined course, stayed by the isle. They sent a crew that, landing, burst away in search of stream and fount and filled the shores with clamor. Downward from his mountain gorge stepped the long-haired, long-beard, solitary, brown, looking hardly human, strangely clad, muttering and mumbling, idiot-like it seemed, with inarticulate rage, and making signs they knew not what. And yet he led the way to where the rivulets of sweet water ran, and ever, as he mingled with the crew and heard them talking, his long bounden tongue was loosened till he made them understand, whom, when their casks were filled, they took aboard, and there the tale he uttered brokenly, scarce credited at first, but more and more amazed and melted all who listened to it. And clothes they gave him, and free passage home. And dull the voyage was with long delays, the vessel scarce seaworthy, but evermore his fancy fled before the lazy wind, returning till beneath a clouded moon, he, like a lover, down through all his blood, drew in the dewy, meadowy, morning breath of England, blown across her ghostly wall. And that same morning, officers and men levied a kindly tax upon themselves, pitying the lonely man, and gave him it. Then, moving up the coast, they landed him even in that harbor whence he sailed before. There, Enoch spoke no word to anyone, but homeward? Home? What home? Had he a home? His home he walked. Bright was that afternoon, sunny but chill, till, drawn through either chasm, rolled a sea haze and whelmed the world in grey. On the nigh naked tree the robin piped disconsolate, and through the dripping haze the dead weight of the dead leaf bore it down. Thicker the drizzle grew, deeper the gloom. Last, as it seemed, a great mist-blotted light flared on him, and he came upon the place. Then, down the long street, having slowly stolen in his heart, foreshadowing all calamity, his eyes upon the stones, he reached the home where Annie lived and loved him, and his babes in those far off 7 happy years were born. But finding neither light nor murmur there, a bill of sail gleamed through the drizzle, crept still downward, thinking, dead, or dead to me. Down to the pool, a narrow wharf he went, seeking a tavern which of old he knew, so propped, worm-eaten, ruinously old, he thought it must have gone, but he was gone who kept it. And his widow, Miriam Lane, with daily dwindling profits, held the house. There Enoch rested silently many days.
But Miriam Lane was good. And garrulous. Told him, with other annals of the port, not knowing. Enoch was so brown, so bowed. So broken. All the story of his house. His baby's death. Her growing poverty. How Philip put her little ones to school and kept them in it. His long wooing her, her slow consent, and marriage, and the birth of Philip's child. And o'er his countenance, no shadow passed, no motion. Anyone regarding well deemed he felt the tale less than the teller. Only when she closed, Enoch, poor man, was cast away and lost. He, shaking his gray head pathetically, repeated, muttering, cast away and lost. Again, in deeper inward whispers, lost. If I might look on her sweet face again, and know that she is happy. So the thought haunted and harassed him and drove him forth at evening when the dull November day was growing duller twilight to the hill. There he sat down, gazing on all below. There did a thousand memories roll upon him, unspeakable for sadness. By and by, the ruddy square of comfortable light, far blazing at the rear of Philip's house, allured him, as the beacon blaze allures the bird of passage, till he madly strikes against it and beats out his weary life. For Philip's dwelling fronted on the street, the latest house to landward, but behind, with one small gate that opened on the waste, flourished a little garden square and walled, and in it throve an ancient evergreen, a yew tree, and all around it ran a walk of shingle, and a walk divided it. But Enoch shunned the middle walk and stole up by the wall behind the yew, and thence that which he better might have shunned, if griefs like his have worse or better. Enoch saw, for cups and silver on the burnished board sparkled and shone, so genial was the hearth. And on the right hand of the hearth he saw Philip, the slighted suitor of old times, stout, rosy, with his babe across his knees. And o'er her second father stooped a girl, a later but a loftier Annie Lee, fair-haired and tall, and from her lifted hand dangled a length of ribbon and a ring to tempt the babe who caught at it and ever missed it, and they all laughed. And on the left hand of the hearth he saw the mother glancing often towards her babe, but turning now and then to speak with him, her son, who stood beside her tall and strong, and saying that which pleased him, for he smiled. Now when the dead man comes alive, beheld his wife no more, and saw the babe hers, yet not his, upon the father's knee, and all the warmth, the peace, and happiness, and his own children tall and beautiful, and him their mother reigning in his place, lord of his rights and of his children's love. Then he, though Miriam Lane had told him all, because things seen are mightier than things heard, staggered and shook, holding the branch, and feared to send abroad a shrill and terrible cry, which in one moment, like the blast of doom, would shatter all the happiness of the hearth. He therefore, turning softly like a thief, lest the harsh shingle should grate underfoot, and feeling all along the garden wall, lest he should swoon and tumble and be found, crept to the gate, and opened it, and closed as lightly as a sick man's chamber door behind him, and came out upon the waste. And there he would have knelt, but that his knees were feeble, so that falling prone, he dug his fingers into the waste. Speech and thought and nature failed a little, and he lay tranced. But when he rose, paced back toward his solitary home again, all down the long and narrow street he went, beating it in upon his weary brain as though it were the burden of a song. Not to tell her, never to let her know. He was not all unhappy. His resolve upbore him, and firm faith and evermore prayer from a living source within the will kept him a living soul. "This miller's wife," he said to Miriam, "that you told me of, has she no fear that her first husband lives?" "Aye, aye, poor soul," said Miriam, "fear enow. If you could tell her you had seen him dead, boy, that would be her comfort." And he thought After the Lord has called me, she shall know. I wait his turn. And Enoch set himself, scorning an alms, to work whereby to live. Almost all things could he turn his hand, thus earned a scanty living for himself. Work without hope. And as the year rolled itself round again to meet the day when Enoch had returned, a languor came upon him. Gentle sickness, gradually weakening the man, till he could do no more but kept the house, his chair, and last his bed. And Enoch bore his weakness cheerfully, for sure he saw death dawning on him and the close of all. He called aloud for Miriam Lane and said, "Woman, I have a secret, only swear before I tell you not to reveal it till you see me dead." "Dead?" clamored the good woman. "Hear him talk? I warrant, man, that we shall bring you round. Swear," adding on sternly, "on the book." And on the book, half frightened, Miriam swore. Then Enoch, rolling his grey eyes upon her, "Did you know, Enoch Arden, of this town?" "Know him," she said. "I knew him far away. I mind him coming down the street, held his head high, and cared for no man, he." Slowly and sadly, Enoch answered her, "His head is low, and no man cares for him. I think I have not 3 days more to live. I am the man." At which the woman gave a half incredulous, half hysterical cry. "You are nay! Sure he was a foot higher than you be." Enoch said again, "My God has bowed me down to what I am. My grief and solitude have broken me. Nevertheless, know that I am he who married, but her name has twice been changed. I married her who married Philip Ray. Sit, listen." Then he told her of his voyage, his wreck, his lonely life, his coming back, his gazing in on Annie, his resolve, and how he kept it. As the woman heard, fast flowed the current of her easy tears, saying only, "See your bairns before you go, eh? Let me fetch him, Arden." And arose, eager to bring them down, for Enoch hung a moment on her words, then replied, "Woman, disturb me not now at the last, but let me hold my purpose till I die. Sit down again, mark me and understand. While I have power to speak, I charge you now, when you shall see her, tell her that I died blessing her, praying for her, loving her, save for the bar between us, loving her as when she laid a head beside my own." And like her mother, that my latest breath was spent in blessing her and praying for her. And tell my son that I died blessing him. And say to Philip that I blessed him too. He never meant us anything but good. But if my children care to see me dead, who hardly saw me living, let them come. I am their father. But she must not come, for my dead face would vex her after life. I shall see him, my babe, in bliss. Wherefore, when I am gone, take, give her this, for it may comfort her. It will, moreover, be a token to her that I am. Then, the third night after this, while Enoch slumbered motionless and pale, and Miriam watched and dozed at intervals, there came so loud a calling of the sea that all the houses in the haven rang. He woke, he rose, he spread his arms abroad, crying with a loud voice, "A sail! A sail! I am saved!" And so fell back and spoke no more. So passed the strong, heroic soul away, and when they buried him, the little port had seldom seen a costly funeral.